Going to molecule, right? Now, if 8 histone molecules, right, that means one histone molecule, same way 8 different histone molecules are combining with each other to form a histone octamer, right? The negatively charged DNA binds around histone octamer to form nucleosome. Now, when a particular histone octamer is formed upon the combination of 8 different histone molecules, what it forms is, along with that histone octamer, when the DNA is wrapped around it, what happens? It forms a nucleosome. So here DNA, which is negatively charged, plus histone octamer, which is positively charged. So positively charged, this is C. The circular green color shape you can see. This is the green color portion is the histone octamer. That is the histone, 8 histone molecules. They are combined and they form a histone octamer. Now the pink color shows the DNA, right? That means the DNA is being wrapped around that histone molecules, right? So when the around the histone octamer is being wrapped with the negatively charged DNA, this is said to be nucleosome, right? So the combination or the formation of nucleosome takes place. So the negatively charged DNA wraps around the positively charged histone octamer, and when these two of them binds, what is formed? Nucleosome, right? So this is the DNA packaging of different types, right? That is, first is prokaryotes and second is eukaryotes, right? Now, one nucleosome has approximate 200 base pair of DNA, right? So, one nucleosome, the DNA which is wrapped around it, in that particular one nucleosome DNA, how many base pair would be there? Approximate 200 base pair. The nucleosome in a chromatin looks similar as the beads present on a string. So, what happens? A small bead-like structure, right? Now, you might have seen the beaded necklace, right? And how it is formed? Small beads are present in the between, right? So such kind of structure is formed here, like a nucleosome in a chromatin, right? That is the DNA and the nucleosome, they all combine to form the chromatin network, right? So that chromatin is, the nucleosome is present, then some kind of DNA, then again nucleosome, DNA, chromosome, DNA, right? So the nucleosome in a chromatin looks similar as the beads present on a string. So small bead-like structures are formed. Chromatin structures are further packaged to form chromatin fibers, right? So what happens? The chromatin structure, they package themselves and they package to form what? Chromatin fibers. So chromatin fibers are formed of chromatin, right? The chromatin fibers coil and condense to form chromosome during the cell division. Now you know about the cell division because you have already studied the cell division part in the standard 11 science, right? So what exactly cell, at what, when the cell division is about to take place, the DNA which is present inside the nucleus, what happens? It condenses, it coils and it condenses and it forms a structure which is known as chromosome. So this chromatin fibers, they coil up and also they want to condense, right? They condense themselves to take a structure which is known as chromosome. Now non-histone chromosomal proteins are there. Now what are non-histone chromosomal proteins? So they are the additional sets of proteins required for the packaging of chromatin at higher level. So when the packaging of the chromatin which is taking place at a higher level, which type of proteins are used? Non-histone chromosomal proteins, right? Now the chromatin are of two types, right? Euchromatin and heterochromatin. Now what is the difference between them? In the euchromatin, they are loosely packed regions of chromatin which stains light, right? So first is, they are loosely packed, right? They are not compact with each other, but they are loosely packed with each other. And the regions of this loosely packed chromatin are, when we are staining them, then they are staining in a light color, right? And when we are talking about heterochromatin, they are densely packed. That means they are compactly packed with each other. And so the densely packed regions of chromatin stains done. So the staining which is carried in eukaryotic chromatin is light, and when it is heterochromatin, it stains dark. So first is they are loosely packed, they stains light, and third is they are transcriptionally active chromatin, right? Transcriptionally active means the transcription is carried out, right? That means the DNA is converted into DNA. DNA is when converted into RNA, that procedure is known as transcription. So this particular chromatin can carry out the transcription. For this reason it is said to be transcriptionally active. So the euchromatin is transcriptionally active, but when we are looking at the heterochromatin, it is transcriptionally inactive, right? So three differences are there. Euchromatin is loosely packed, while heterochromatin are densely packed. The euchromatin stains light, and the heterochromatin stains dark. The euchromatin is transcriptionally active, or we can say they are able to carry out the transcription, but when we are looking at heterochromatin, they are transcriptionally inactive. So this is all about the packaging of DNA helix in eukaryotes, right? So you have, if this question is asked, you can write this way. Whichever points I have mentioned, these are the main points of this topic which should be mentioned, right? So the next topic of this chapter is transforming principle. It is one of the important topic of this chapter, and this is frequently asked in exam also, right? So starting with the transforming principle, it is also said to be the Grift transformation principle, or it is also been known as the Grift experiment. Okay, so if it is not written as transforming principle, you can if it is written as Grift experiment, then you have to write the transforming principle, right? The Grift perform experiments with the bacteria Streptococcus pneumoniae, right? So Grift, the scientist Grift, he performed several experiments with this bacteria, and he took two strains of this bacteria. First is R strain and second is S strain, right? This two strain he took, and he carried out several experiments on this. These two strains are of this particular bacteria, that is Streptococcus pneumoniae, right? Now the difference between these two strains has been written here. This is about the S strain and this is about the R strain. The S strain produces smooth colonies on culture plate, right? So when you are going for the culturing of this S strain, what type of colonies do you get in it? Smooth colonies. That means the texture will be smooth. And when we are talking about R strain, they produce rough colonies on the culture plate, right? The S strain has a polysaccharide put on it, but when we are talking about R strain, they do not have any polysaccharide coat, right? This S strain bacteria are virulent. Virulent means they have the ability to cause the pneumonia. That means they are pathogenic, right? But when we are talking about R strain, the R strain are non-virulent in nature. That means they does not cause pneumonia. That means they does not have the ability to cause pneumonia. So among this, the main thing you have to remember is the virulence and non-virulent type. The S strain is the virulent type, which is responsible for causing pneumonia, and the R strain cannot cause pneumonia. Now we are going to see the main principle, the main experiment, that how the Grift carried out the experiment on the mice. He choose mice for this experiment to understand that how this two of the strains works on it, right? So first what he took is, he took S strain. So S strain is virulent, that means it causes pneumonia. So the S strain, which is virulent in nature, he took this and he injected this S strain into the mice. So the mice is going to develop the infection of pneumonia and the mice dies, right? So this was the first experiment. The second experiment he carried out by taking the R strain. But the R strain is non-virulent in nature, that means it does not have the ability to cause the pneumonia. So this R strain again he took and he injected that into the mice. And here what happens, as this R strain does not have the ability to infection does not develop, and due to this the mice lives, right? Now what happened? What he did is he took S strain, but the S strain was heat killed, right? That means when the S strain was taken, first he heated it, right? So whatever the bacterium was there, right, it was killed. So this reason it is said to be heat killed. So the S, it is S strain, right? It is virulent, it was virulent in nature, but when it was carried out or then the heat was given to that S strain, what happened? It was heat killed. Now this heat killed S strain is being injected. Once we injected this S strain heat killed into the mice, and as the heat killed, it was heat killed S strain, what happened? This S strain does not produces pneumonia, or it does not causes the infection of pneumonia, and for this reason what happened? The mice lives. Now what he did is he took the R strain, which is normal, the live strain of R, right, and we took the S killed, S strain heat killed bacteria, right? So the R, he took R strain, which was the main normal one, and we took heat killed S strain. Now he merged this both in a culture and he injected into the mice, and here what happened? The mice dies. Now you might be having a question that if this was heat killed, right, this R strain does not have the ability to cause pneumonia. Even this S strain was heat killed, right? That means it was not having the ability further to cause the pneumonia. Then how the mice died, right? So what happens here? The R strain was when mixed with the heat killed S strain. What happened? The S strain was comparatively, what happened? They were dependent on this R strain. This was not heat killed, right? But this was live strain. For this reason, this S strain bacteria was feeded on the R strain bacteria. And for this reason, what happened? This S strain bacteria, right? What happened? Feeded on them, and what happened? This R strain bacteria, which were non-virulent in nature, got transformed to S strain bacteria, right? So this R strain, as they were transformed to S strain, even this bacteria which were transformed, they were not able to cause the infection of pneumonia. And for this reason, when it was injected into the mice dies. So here, what exactly the Griffith is trying to tell us is that the R strain and the S strain, right, amongst both of them, one was virulent, but when we took the non-virulent one, right, and this non-virulent one is, non-virulent one was when combined with the S strain that was hit killed, what happened? This, there was some exchange of the genetic material took place between these two strains, or the two strains bacteria, right? So for this reason, as the genetic material was passed, for this reason what happened? This R strain bacteria were transformed to S strain bacteria. So for this reason, this was not having the property of virulence, but when it was transformed to S strain, due to that the S strain's virulence property was transformed to, and for this reason when it was injected into the mice died. So this was the experiment of the grip which was carried out on the mice to understand that the transformation takes place. Now the transformation takes place, that means something is passing from one body to the next body, or from the one cell to the next cell, right? But why, which material is responsible for it? Now we are going to see. So Griffith also took out some study related to the biochemical nature of this experiment, right? And in that he studied that which material was responsible for carrying out the transformation. So after this we are going to see the next is the biochemical nature of this transforming principle.
So this is the biochemical nature of transforming experiment, right? Every method and methodology worked to determine the biochemical nature of genetic material which was responsible for the transformation. So to understand what exactly the genetic material is, every method and methodology, they worked on this principle and understood that what was responsible for the transformation. Purified biochemicals, that is protein,
digest proteins, right? So when the along with this, when the RNAs and proteases were added, the digestion of RNA and protein occurred. So only DNA was left, and for this reason, what happened? The R strain, right? It was transformed to S strain, and as the R strain transformed to S strain, it developed virulence, and hence the mice dies. So if the mice die, that means the transformation occurred, right? Same way, the next is the S strain and R strain, but here instead of RNAs and proteases, they added DNAs, right? So it only digested the DNA, and the leftover which was left in the material was the proteins and the RNA, and hence the transformation does not took place, and for this reason the mice lives. So at last every McMahon and McCarthy concluded the DNA is a genetic material, because only the DNA was responsible for the transformation, right? And so the biochemical nature of transforming experiment explains that the DNA is the genetic material. And here we complete this topic, and I hope to see you again. Thank you.